This is Courtney, licensed professional counselor with over a decade of experience. And this is Trisha, and I woke up with some L-Fox today. Fox, that sounds adorable, but I feel like it's probably not. Yeah, it's not like the fox animal. It's matted lock. Of hair. Oh, that is far less cute and snuggly. Yeah, I was tossing and turning. Stress and anxiety and school and all of the things. I do know how that goes. Started a new term or semester, and Courtney and I were just going over our syllabi. Yes, so, anyways, that's that, and I don't know why I feel sleepy today, but I am, so
probably because you were tossing and turning all night.
I know, I went to bed like hella early though, but that's alright. So, just to give a precursor, Courtney did again write this one, And she told me, she informed me that I have some really long like spells of reading. So I'm going to try to go slow and measure, because when I have several paragraphs in a row, that's when I tend to fumble my words. I will do my best, guys, to not fumble the words.
I think you'll do fine.
You know, I try. I'm getting better. But I do tend to speak quickly when I should slow down. So man, I'm listening to myself. I'm really boring. So anyway,
well, we're coming back to our part two. Earl Nelson, right, aka the Gorilla Killer, or the Gorilla Man Killer, and so before we get into that, though, I've got hopefully not a hard question.
Okay.
Today.
I mean, I'm not brain dead. I'm just not feeling clever.
That's okay.
So, okay. Have at it.
All right. So, Trisha, what was your, like, favorite go-to snack food when you were a kid? Like, the one that you're like, this is what I want.
So it would probably be those toaster strudels. Do you remember those?
I may have eaten
still around, they were better than a Pop-Tart. And my parents didn't get them very often, but my friend Alana, her parents always got them for her. So I got him to try a fruit roll up and he did not care for it. He tried it though, but he was like, I think it wasn't a fruit by the foot, it was a fruit roll up, so it was a super waxy.
Yeah, the more plastic,
yeah,
one.
You kind of have to rip it with your teeth.
Mm-hmm.
Which I also find delicious, but he found very weird and plastic tasting.
I mean, yeah.
So Yusuf, if you listen to us, which I doubt you do, that was me.
Remember the terrible Gushers commercials where, like, the kids would eat it and then their head would turn into fruit? And
Yeah,
that was real creepy.
It's kind of fun to watch old commercials.
It is.
I mean, you weren't really around the 80s, but the 80s had some great ones. As well, when I watch him, it's weird how it, like, transcends you in time.
Takes you right back.
Much anymore because I don't watch live TV very much anymore.
Same.
So for sports.
Right. And they have very kind of specific commercials.
Yeah. A lot of times there's sports commercials.
Right.
Yeah.
name of the book is Bestial.
Bestial.
And then there's a subtitle. I think the true story of a true American monster.
Okay.
Something like that.
Do you want to recap for us?
Yes. Okay. I'll do a quick recap. Last week. So we learned that Earl Nelson was born around the turn of the century. Both of his parents died of syphilis. When he was a baby, and he was raised by his strict and religious grandmother. Earl suffered several major illnesses and head injuries as a child, and displayed very odd and aggressive behaviors from a pretty young age, including hallucinations. After his grandma died when he was 14, he started struggling with drinking, fighting, and his mental health just kept getting worse. And he ended up in prison and then at the state hospital. And after being kicked out by his eventual wife, he attacked a young girl and found himself back at the hospital after having a psychotic break.
So we left off in early 1925 with Earl having been released from the Napa State Mental Hospital, where he spent about 3 years after assaulting that girl that Courtney just talked about. He was home with his wife just a few weeks before he felt the urge to wander. And he left.
wasn't long before his violent tendencies led to murder for the first time. And in San Francisco, it was February 20th, 1926. Earl knocked on the door of a boarding house that had a room for rent sign in the window. The boarding house was run by a 62-year-old widow named Clara Newman. Earl was dressed nicely and politely asked about the open room. Clara invited Earl inside to show him the room. After a while, Clara's nephew, Merton, came down from the apartment he rented upstairs in the home and saw Earl opening the front door to leave. He asked Earl what he was doing, and Earl responded by saying that he wanted to rent the room and to tell the landlady that he would be back in an hour. Well, a few more hours passed and Martin realized that he had not seen or heard from his Aunt Clara, and neither had any of the other boarders. They began searching the house and soon found Clara's body in the vacant room, lying on the floor with her skirt bunched up around her hips. She had been strangled to death by somebody's bare hands and then sexually assaulted after she died. The police were called to investigate, but there was not much to go off of, as Merton had not gotten a good look at the man who had come to inquire about the room. Courtney, if this is his first murder, or do you think it is his first murder? And what do you think be surprised if this were not actually Earl's first murder, but it is the first that we know of, and it's definitely the first that kind of sets this pattern in motion. So with his level of aggression and strength, I can imagine that he may have, you know, maybe killed someone unintentionally prior to this, like in a bar fight or something similar. Which may have sort of ignited that urge to kill. And then I also believe